already Wednesday? It's time for Bookmark Book Club? Wait, it's Thursday? I'm a day late? Well, I like it better on Thursday anyway. What do you think, humbug?
Ah, yes, Thursday, day of Thor, greatest day of the week. I wholeheartedly agree with you. Who are you anyway?
I'm Jules with Haverford Township Free Library, and this is Bookmark Book Club, where we will be picking up where we left off of The Phantom Tollbooth.
Phantom Tollbooth? That is the greatest work of literature ever written.
It's pretty good. So if you remember, the last thing that happened was that Milo and his friends left Dr. Discord and the Din behind and went off toward the Valley of Sound. And that is where we will pick up. So let's get going. Chapter 12, The Silent Valley. How agreeable and pleasant this valley is, thought Milo, as once again they bounced along the highway, with the humbug humming snatches of old songs to his own vast amusement, and Tuck sniffing contentedly at the wind. I really can't see what Dr. Discord was so concerned about. There certainly can't be anything unpleasant along this road. And just as the thought crossed his mind, they passed through a heavy stone gateway, and everything was very different. At first it was difficult to tell just what had changed. It all looked the same, and it all smelled the same, but for some reason, nothing sounded the same. I wonder what's happened, said Milo. At least that's what he tried to say, for although his lips moved, not a sound came from his mouth. And suddenly he realized what it was, for talk was no longer ticking, and the humbug, although happily singing, was doing so in complete silence. The wind no longer rustled the leaves, the car no longer squeaked, and the insects no longer buzzed in the fields. Not the slightest thing could be heard, and it felt as if, in some mysterious way, a switch had been thrown, and all the sound in the world had been turned off at the same instant. The humbug, suddenly realizing what had happened, leaped to his feet in terror. And Tak worriedly checked to see if he was still keeping time. It was certainly a strange feeling to know that no matter how loudly or softly you chatted or rattled or bumped, it all came out the same way as nothing. How dreadful, thought Milo, as he slowed down the car. The three of them began to talk and shout at once with absolutely no result, until hardly noticing where they were going, they had driven into the midst of a large crowd of people, marching along the road. Some of them were singing at the tops of their non-existent voices, and the others were carrying large signs which proclaimed, "Down with silence! All quiet is no diet! It's laudable to be audible! More sound for all!" And one enormous banner stated simply, "Hear, hear!" Except for these, and the big brass cannon being pulled along behind, they all looked very much like the residents of any other small valley to which you've never been. When the car had stopped, one of them held up a placard which said, "Welcome to the Valley of Sound," and the others cheered as loudly as possible, which was not very loud at all. "Have you come to help us?" asked another, stepping forward with his question. "Please," added the third. Milo tried desperately to say who he was and where he was going, but to no avail. As he did, four more placards announced, "Listen, look carefully, and we will tell you of our terrible misfortune." And while two of them held up a large blackboard, a third, writing as fast as he could, explained why there was nothing but quiet in the Valley of Sound. "At a place in the valley not far from here," he began, "where the echoes used to gather and the winds came to rest, there is a great stone fortress, and in it lives the Soundkeeper, who rules the land. When the old King of Wisdom drove the demons into the distant mountains, he appointed her guardian of all sounds and noises, past, present, and future. For years she ruled as a wise and beloved monarch, each morning at sunrise releasing the day's new sounds to be borne by the winds throughout the kingdom, and each night at moonset gathering in the old sounds to be catalogued and filed in the vast storage vaults below." The writer paused for a moment to mop his brow, and then, since the blackboard was full, erased it completely and continued anew from the top. She was generous to a fault and provided us with all the sound we could possibly use. For singing as we worked, for bubbling pots of stew, for the chop of an axe and the crash of a tree, for the creak of a hinge and the hoot of an owl, for the squish of a shoe in the mud and the friendly tapping of rain on the roof, and for the sweet music of pipes and the sharp snap of winter ice cracking on the ground. He paused again as a tear of longing rolled from cheek to lip with the sweet, salty taste of an old memory. And all these sounds, when once used, would be carefully placed in alphabetical order and neatly kept for future reference. Everyone lived in peace, and the valley flourished as the happy home of sound. But then things began to change, slowly at first. And then in a rush, more people came to settle here and brought with them new ways and new sounds, and some very beautiful and some less so. But everyone was so busy with the things that had to be done that they scarcely had time to listen at all. And as you know, a sound which is not heard disappears forever and is not to be found again. People laughed less and grumbled more, sang less and shouted more, and the sounds they made grew louder and uglier. It became difficult to hear even the birds or the breeze, and soon everyone stopped listening for them. He again cleared the blackboard as the humbug choked back a sob and continued writing. The soundkeeper grew worried and disconsolate. Each day there were fewer sounds to be collected, and most of those were hardly worth keeping. Many people thought it was the weather, and others blamed the moon, but the general consensus of opinion held that the trouble began at the time that rhyme and reason were banished. But no matter what the cause, no one knew what to do. Then one day, Dr. Discord appeared in the valley with his wagon of medicines and the bluish, smoggy din. He made a thorough examination and promised to cure everyone of everything, and the soundkeeper let him try. He gave several bad-tasting spoonfuls of medicine to every adult and child, and it worked, but not really as expected, for he cured everybody of everything but noise. The soundkeeper became furious. She chased him from the valley forever and then issued the following decree. From this day forward, the valley of sound shall be silent. Since sound is no longer appreciated, I hereby abolish it. Please return all unused amounts to the fortress immediately. And that's the way it has been ever since, he concluded sadly. There's nothing we can do to change it, and each day new hardships are reported. A small man with his arms full of letters and messages pushed through the crowd and offered them to Milo. Milo took one which read, "Dear Soundkeeper, we had a thunderstorm last week, and the thunder still hasn't arrived. How long should we wait? Yours truly, a friend." And then he took a telegram which stated, "Band concert, great success, stop. When may we expect the music? Stop." "Now you see," continued the writer, "why you must help us attack the fortress and free sound." "What can I do?" wrote Milo. "You must visit the soundkeeper and bring from the fortress one sound, no matter how small, with which to load our cannon. For if we reach the walls with the slightest noise, they will collapse and free the rest. It won't be easy, for she is hard to deceive, but you must try." Milo thought for just a moment, and then, with a resolute, "I shall," volunteered to go. Within a few minutes, he stood bravely at the fortress door. "Knock, knock," he wrote neatly on a piece of paper, which he pushed under the crack. In a moment, the great portal swung open, and as it closed behind him, a gentle voice sang out,
"Right this way, I'm in the parlor."
"Can I talk now?" cried Milo happily, hearing his voice once again.
"Yes, but only in here,"
she replied softly.
"Now do come into the parlor."
Milo walked slowly down the long hallway and into the little room where the soundkeeper sat listening intently to an enormous radio set, whose switches, dials, knobs, meters, and speaker covered one whole wall, and which at the moment was playing nothing.
"Isn't it lovely?" she sighed. "It's my favorite program. 15 minutes of silence, and after that there's a half hour of quiet, and then an interlude of lull. Why, did you know that there are almost as many kinds of stillness as there are sounds? But sadly enough, no one pays any attention to them these days. Have you ever heard the wonderful silence just before the dawn?" she inquired, "or the quiet and calm just as a storm ends? Or perhaps you know the silence when you haven't the answer to a question you've been asked. Or the hush of a country road at night. Or the expectant pause in a room full of people when someone is just about to speak. Or most beautiful of all, the moment after the door closes and you're alone in the whole house. Each one is different, you know, and all very beautiful, if you listen carefully.
As she spoke, the thousands of little bells and chimes which covered her from head to toe tinkled softly, and as if in reply, the telephone began to ring too. For someone who loves silence, she certainly talks a great deal, thought Milo.
At one time, I was able to listen to any sound made at any place, at any time,
the sound keeper remarked, pointing towards the radio wall.
But now I merely...
Pardon me, interrupted Milo as the phone continued to ring, but aren't you going to answer it?
Oh, no, not in the middle of the program,
she replied, and turned up the silence a little bit louder. But it may be important, insisted Milo.
Not at all,
she assured him.
It's only me. It gets so lonely around here with no sounds to distribute or collect that I call myself 7 or 8 times a day just to see how I am.
How are you? He asked politely.
Not very well, I'm afraid. I seem to have a touch of static,
she complained.
But what brings you here? Of course, you've come to tour the vaults. Well, they're usually open to the public only on Mondays from 2 to 4, but since you've traveled so far, we'll have to make an exception. Follow me, please.
She quickly bounced to her feet with a chorus of jingles and chimes and started down the hallway.
Don't you just love jingles and chimes? I do,
she answered quickly.
Besides, they're very convenient, for I'm always getting lost in the big fortress, and all I have to do is listen for them, and then I know exactly where I am.
They entered a tiny cage-like elevator and traveled down for fully 3/4 of a minute, stopping finally in an immense vault, whose long lines of file drawers and storage bins stretched in all directions from where here began to where there ended, and from floor to ceiling.
Every sound that's ever been made in history is kept here,
said the sound keeper, skipping down one of the corridors with Milo in hand.
For instance, look here.
She opened one of the drawers and pulled out a small brown envelope.
This is the exact tune George Washington whistled when he crossed the Delaware on that icy night in 1777.
Milo peered into the envelope, and sure enough, that's exactly what was in it. But why do you collect them all? He asked as she closed the drawer.
If we didn't collect them,
said the sound keeper as they continued to stroll through the vault,
the air would be full of old sounds and noises bouncing around and bumping into things. It would be terribly confusing, because you'd never know whether you were listening to an old one or a new one. Besides, I do like to collect things, and there are more sounds than almost anything else. Why, I have everything here from the buzz of a mosquito 1,000,000 years ago to what your mother said to you this morning. And if you come back here in 2 days, I'll tell you what she said tomorrow. It's really very simple. Let me show you. Say a word, any word.
Hello, said Milo, for that was all he could think of.
Now where do you think it went?
She asked with a smile. I don't know, said Milo, shrugging his shoulders. I always thought that
most people do,
she hummed, peering down one of the corridors.
Now let me see. First we find the cabinet with today's sounds. Ah, here it is. Then we look under G for greetings, and then under M for Milo. And here it is,
hello,
already in its envelope. So you see, the whole system is quite automatic. It's a shame we hardly use it anymore.
That's wonderful, gasped Milo. May I have one little sound as a souvenir?
Certainly,
she said with pride, and then immediately thinking better of it, added,
not! And don't try to take one because it's strictly against the rules.
Milo was crestfallen. He had no idea how to steal a sound, even the smallest one, for the soundkeeper always had at least one eye carefully focused on him.
Now for a look at the workshops,
she cried, whisking him through another door into a large abandoned laboratory filled with old pieces of equipment, all untended and rusting.
This is where we used to invent the sounds,
she said wistfully. Do they have to be invented? Asked Milo, who seemed surprised at almost everything she told him. I thought they just were.
No one realizes how much trouble we go through to make them,
she complained.
Why, at one time this shop was crowded and busy from morning to night.
But how do you invent a sound? Milo inquired.
Oh, that's very easy, she said. First, you must decide exactly what the sound looks like. For each sound has its own exact shape and size. Then you make some of them here in the shop and grind each one 3 times into an invisible powder and throw a little of each into the air every time you need it.
But I've never seen a sound, Milo insisted.
You've never seen them out there, she said,
waving her arm in the general direction of everywhere.
Except every once in a while on a very cold morning when they freeze. But in here, we see them all the time. Here, let me show you.
She picked up a padded stick and struck a nearby bass drum 6 times. 6 large, woolly, fluffy cotton balls, each about 2 feet across, rolled silently out onto the floor.
You see? She said, putting some of them into a large grinder. Now listen.
And she took a pinch of the invisible powder and threw it into the air with a boom, boom, boom.
Do you know what a hand clap looks like?
Milo shook his head.
Try it,
she commanded. He clapped his hands once, and a single sheet of clean white paper fluttered to the floor. He tried it 3 more times, and 3 more sheets of paper did the very same thing. And then he applauded as fast as he could, and a great cascade of papers filled the air.
Isn't that simple? And it's the same for all sounds. If you think about it, you'll soon know what each one looks like. Take laughter, for instance, she said, laughing brightly.
And 1,000 tiny, brightly colored bubbles flew into the air and popped noiselessly.
Or speech, she continued. Some of it is light and airy, some sharp and pointed. But most of it, I'm afraid, is just heavy and dull.
How about music? Asked Milo excitedly.
Right over here. We weave it on our looms. Symphonies are large, beautiful carpets with all the rhythms and melodies woven in. Concertos are the tapestries. And all the other bolts of cloth are serenades, waltzes, overtures, and rhapsodies. And we also have some of the songs that you often sing,
she cried, holding up a handful of brightly colored handkerchiefs. She stopped for a moment and said sadly,
"We even had one section over there that did nothing but put the sound of the ocean into seashells. This was once such a happy place."
"Then why don't you make the sound for everyone now?" he shouted so eagerly that the sound keeper leapt back in surprise.
"Don't shout so, young man. If there's one thing we need more of around here, it's less noise. Now come with me and I'll tell you about it. And put that down immediately!"
Her last remark was directed toward Milo's effort to stuff one of the large drum beats into his back pocket. They returned quickly to the parlor, and when the soundkeeper had settled herself into a chair and carefully turned the radio to a special hour of hush, Milo asked his question once again in a somewhat lower voice.
"It doesn't make me happy to hold back the sounds," she began softly, "for if we listen to them carefully, they can sometimes tell us things far better than words."
"But if that is so," asked Milo, and he had no doubt that it was, "shouldn't you release them?"
"Never," she cried. "They just use them to make horrible noises, which are ugly to see and worse to hear. I leave all that to Dr. Discord and that awful, awful din."
"But some noises are good sounds, aren't they?" he insisted.
"That may be true,"
she replied stubbornly.
"But if they won't make the sounds that I like, they won't make any."
He started to say, and it got no further than that. For a while he was about to say that he didn't think that it was quite fair, a thought to which the obstinate soundkeeper might not have taken kindly. He suddenly discovered the way that he would carry his little sound from the fortress. In the instant between saying the word and before it sailed off into the air, he had clamped his lips shut, and the butt was trapped in his mouth, all made but not spoken.
"Well, I mustn't keep you all day," she said impatiently. "Now turn out your pockets so I can see that you didn't steal anything, and you can be on your way."
When he had satisfied the soundkeeper, he nodded his farewell, for it would have been most impractical to say thank you or good afternoon, and raced out the door.
"Wait a minute. Is that the end of the chapter? What happens to Milo in the Valley of Sound, and what happens to me?"
"Well, I guess I could read a little further. Just a little further. Just for you. Here's the very beginning of the next chapter, chapter 13, Unfortunate Conclusions."
With his mouth shut tight and his feet moving as fast as thoughts could make them, Milo ran all the way back to the car. There was great excitement when he arrived, and as Tak raced happily down the road to greet him, the humbug personally accepted all the congratulations from the crowd. "Where is the sound?" someone hastily scribbled on the blackboard, and they all waited anxiously for the reply. Milo caught his breath, picked up the chalk, and explained simply, "It's on the tip of my tongue." Several people excitedly threw their hats into the air, and some shouted what would have been a loud hurrah, and the rest pushed the heavy cannon into place. They aimed it directly at the thickest part of the fortress wall and packed it full of gunpowder. Milo stood on tiptoe, leaned into the cannon's mouth, and parted his lips. The small sound dropped silently to the bottom, and everything was ready. In another moment, the fuse was lit and sputtering. "I hope no one gets hurt," thought Milo, and before he had time to think again, an immense cloud of gray and white smoke leaped from the gun, and along with it, so softly that it was hardly heard, came the sound of "butt." It flew toward the wall for several seconds on a high, lazy arc, and then struck, ever so lightly, to the right of the big door. For an instant, there was an ominous stillness, quieter and more silent than ever before, as if the air was holding its breath. And then, almost immediately, there was a blasting, roaring, thundering smash, followed by a crashing, shattering, bursting crash. And as every stone in the fortress came toppling to the ground, and the vaults burst open, spilling the sounds of history into the wind, every sound that had ever been uttered or made, from way back to when there were none, to way up when there were too many, came hurtling out of the debris in a way that sounded as though everyone in the world was laughing, whistling, shouting, crying, singing, whispering, humming, screaming, coughing, and sneezing, all at the same time. There were bits of old speeches floating about, as well as recited lessons, gunshots from old wars, babies' cries, auto horns, waterfalls, electric fans, galloping horses, and a great deal of everything else. For a while, there was total and deafening confusion, and then, almost as quickly as they'd come, all the old sounds disappeared over the hill in search of the new freedom, and things were normal again. The people quickly went about their busy, talkative business, and as the smoke and dust cleared, only Milo, Tak, and the humbug noticed the sound keeper sitting disconsolately on a pile of rubble. "I'm terribly sorry," said Milo sympathetically, as the three of them went to console her.
"But we had to do it," added Tak, sniffing around the ruins.
"What a terrible mess,"
observed the humbug, with his knack for saying exactly the wrong thing. The soundkeeper looked around with an expression of unrelieved sadness on her unhappy face.
"It will take years to collect all those sounds again," she sobbed, "and even longer to put them back in proper order. But it's all my fault, for you can't improve sound by having only silence. The problem is to use each at the proper time."
As she spoke, the familiar and unmistakable squinch, squanch of the Din's heavy footsteps could be heard plodding over the hill, and when he finally appeared, he was dragging an incredibly large sack behind him.
"Can anyone use these sounds?" he puffed, mopping his forehead. "They all came over the hill at once, and none of them are awful enough for me."
The soundkeeper peered into the sack, and there were all the sounds which had burst from the walls.
"How nice of you to return them!" she cried happily. "You and the doctor must come by for an evening of beautiful music when my fortress is repaired."
The thought of it so horrified the Din that he excused himself immediately and dashed off down the road in a great panic.
"I hope I haven't offended him," she said with some concern.
"He only likes unpleasant sounds," volunteered Tak.
"Ah, yes," she sighed. "I keep forgetting that many people do. But I suppose they are necessary, for you never really know how pleasant one was unless you know how unpleasant it wasn't."
She paused for a moment, and then continued,
"If only rhyme and reason were here, I'm sure things would improve."
"That's why we're going to rescue them," said Milo proudly.
"What a long, hard journey that will be! You'll need some nourishment," she cried, handing Milo a small brown package, neatly wrapped and tied with string. "Now remember, they're not for eating, but for listening, because you'll often be hungry for sounds as well as for food. Here are street noises at night, train whistles a long way off,
dry leaves burning, busy department stores, crunching toast, creaking bed springs, and of course, all kinds of laughter. There's a little of each, and in far-off lonely places, I think you'll be glad to have them.
I'm sure we will, replied Milo gratefully.
Just take this road to the sea and turn left, she told them. You'll soon be in Digitopolis.
And almost before she had finished, they had said goodbye and left the valley behind them.
Wow, Milo really saved the day there. Remember how the soundkeeper was showing Milo what sounds look like before they turn into sounds? Think about the different sounds you hear throughout the day, and think to yourself what they would look like if you could see them. What do you think, humbug? Now he's sleeping on the job. Anyway, that's everything for today, and I'll see you later, where we will pick up where we left off of The Phantom Tollbooth. Bye!